Grazie, buongiorno. Il mio compito è quello di portarvi il saluto del magnifico rettore Eugenio Gaudio, salutarvi, di ringraziare l'illustre ospite che oggi terrà la lezione, il professor Marchisio, come sapete, da anni è impegnato su tanti fronti, quello della didattica ma anche diciamo all'esterno dell'università, ricopre incarichi importanti e questo master sulla tutela internazionale dei diritti umani io credo sia molto importante non solo perché fu fondato da una grande professoressa che ha insegnato in questo Ateneo, che è la Maria Rita Saul, ma è molto importante per il tema che affronta. Con qualcuno di voi forse ci siamo visti nell'ambito delle normali lezioni del master, mi sembra di vedere qualche viso noto e come dissi quel giorno che feci lezione, ricordatevi che questo problema che oggi noi chiamiamo diritti umani è un problema antico, è un problema che era stato affrontato da molti teorici a partire già da addirittura quasi 2000 anni fa, insomma anche i primi padri della Chiesa si ponevano il problema della tutela, della dignità umana, eccetera. E questo problema riemerse nella sua potenza durante il periodo in cui imperava il sistema economico della schiavitù, per esempio, quindi tutto il dibattito sulla di nuovo dignità umana, poi per fortuna direi, nonostante conflitti mondiali, eccetera, si è arrivati a farne una struttura delle relazioni internazionali molto importante. La nostra Europa si basa sul fatto che chi aderisce all'Unione Europea rispetti i diritti umani, che significano le minoranze, che significano il rispetto di genere, che significa il diritto alla vita, il diritto all'alimentazione e, come sapete, in questi giorni anche dell'Expo, dove si discute molto di questi temi. Quindi credo che sia, sono sicuro, è un master molto importante che il professor Marchisio con grande dedizione porta avanti con alcuni suoi collaboratori e che dà un grande lustro al nostro Ateneo. Quindi un grazie al professor Marchisio e un grazie al professore von der Dunk che oggi terrà questa interessante conferenza sul problema dello spazio comune e della governance, cioè sul modo di governare, perché so che spesso governance si confonde con governo, invece governance è il modo di governare, che è una cosa leggermente diversa. Quindi grazie e buon lavoro.
Ecco, grazie Antonello per essere venuto tra i molti impegni qui a salutare il professor Franz von der Dunk, we welcome him today at Sapienza University, and we are very happy to have him talking about this fascinating issue of the Tales of Two Oceans, governance of terrestrial and outer space commons. This is within not only the Master on International Protection of Human Rights, but also within the doctoral program on public, administrative and international law, which is organized here in Sapienza. Just a few words about Professor von der Dunk. Professor von der Dunk, I know him since many years when we were younger, but I was younger in particular. In Paris at the European Space Agency when we met for the first time within the board of directors of the European Center for Space Law. And we had always a very good relation, a very friendly relation, and I should say that it is one of the most, distinguished professors in this special field of law, which is space law. Presently, after a long career at the Leiden University, he is Harvey and Susan Perlman alumni Otmer Professor of Space Law at the University of Nebraska, Lincoln, in the United States. He leads a unique LLM program on space, cyber, and telecommunications law. Of course, he is also a private consultant. He has his own consultancy in space law and policy, Black Holes, in the Netherlands, and he is member of the board of directors of the International Institute for Space Law and the European Center for Space Law, which both are involved in the organization of the moot court competition in honor of a judge and former president of the International Court of Justice, Manfred Lax, which is organized yearly, the European round in one European university. Some years ago, I don't remember, we were in this same room for the inauguration of the European round here in Rome with, I don't remember, 12, 13 teams from all over Europe. And I see that also Professor Bonafé was member of one of the benches. And we had some days of intense labor, intense work for selecting the most, the best European team to go to the finals in, I don't remember where, I think in Cape Town.
Yeah.
Where they are judged by three sitting judges of the International Court of Justice. And it is a nice experience. This year we will have the same at the University of Belgrade at the first week of June. We need an entire week because the number of teams is growing and growing and posing problems of organization, considering also that the European Center of Space Law takes at its own charge the space, the costs for accommodation of the teams. So this is something that is a little bit, I'm very sorry that this coincides with the annual meeting of the Italian Society of International Law, which will be held in Macerata at the end of the same week, but as president of this ESL, I cannot but stay in Belgrade until the end of the week. So you will excuse my absence to the meeting of the Italian Society of International Law. I think that I can have an idea. I just wanted to mention also that Professor von der Dunk published several books, a lot of articles, etc., as usual in this case, but I'm particularly happy that he brought me this handbook of space law, which is just out, published by Elgar, and he's a very interesting book. He of course contributed to it and edited it because there are contributions from several distinguished specialists. It is interesting because it focuses on two main issues. On one side, it focuses on the origins of the regulation, the international regulation of space activities, activities of states in outer space, which is state-oriented, because at the time there were only state activities in outer space. Now the framework is changing rapidly, partly already changed, and we have a lot of commercial activities in outer space, private activities. And you know that there is one main point in the Outer Space Treaty of 67 that says that state bear responsibility also for private activities in outer space. And this new framework is also connected with the theme. I think I don't know what is about this. I can imagine,
but
it is linked to the issue that Professor von der Donck will address today, which is governance of terrestrial and outer space commons. Whatever the legal regime of I don't know, deep seas, deep seas soils and subsoils, outer space, celestial bodies like asteroids, the moon, etc., they have in common one thing, and one thing is that they are open to all. They are open to all with different graduation, with different legal regime. We have the Res Communis Omnium for outer space and high seas. We have the common heritage of humankind corrected by some agreements in 1994 in the case of the deep seas resources. But the point is the same. When the international community think about these terrestrial and outer space zones, they are seen as commons, as global commons. Now, in my mind, global commons is not a legal notion, it's more a legal, a notion that was invented in the 60s, if I'm not wrong, at the end of the 60s. And in any case, they pose problems of how to govern them, how to manage them, and how to allow, if any, the exploitation of the resources. Now, I will take two points, then leaving the floor to Professor van der Donck, that draw my attention, also for your attention. We had in the last years some very, very remarkable developments in the field of the deep seas mineral resources exploitation, because as of July 2014, the International Seabed Authority, set up by the Montego Bay Convention of 1982, has approved 26 contracts for the exploitation of mineral resources in the area. Then we had one state, one private company, sorry, the Nautilus Minerals, that got from the Papua New Guinea government a concession for exploiting a first mine in the deep ocean of the PNG continental shelf. Other requests for exploitation were rejected, for instance, by New Zealand for environmental problems. But still, there is movement in this area that seems to be quite, absolutely calm and without any development. I was still thinking the time when the point was this kind of exploitation is not feasible, is not economically rentable, etc. So it cannot be, we should not think about that. But now it seems that things are moving, and there are, of course, this is the moment that the legal regime established for the deep seas should be, put at the experience, at the practice level, and see if it is suitable or not. Second, surprisingly, last year in July, we had two members of the USA Congress that presented a bill, a draft bill concerning the exploitation of asteroids. And it is very interesting to see that this, of course, is the consequence of the fact that private sector is moving toward such kind of ventures. Some of them, deep exploration, etc. There are three or four companies that are thinking about this. They say we are ready to go and exploit
the rare metals that are inside the asteroids. We can extract them and have a profitable economic activity. And this bill was just to protect the property rights on these rare metals that could be extracted from asteroids. So this is the case is interesting because there was surely Professor von der Dunk will mention, there was some hearing in the Congress also to ask the opinion of experts, because the bill says that all this should be done respecting the international obligation of the United States. But the point is, how can such a regime be put in place respecting the international obligation of the United States? Is it possible to have a regime of exploitation that is compatible, consistent with the existing treaties in force? Of course, this is an important problem, I think, and the fact that for the time being the USA put a moratorium on this issue, in the sense that the project was withdrawn to think better about it, doesn't mean that things are not moving, because there is a group, international group at the International Academy of Astronautics, which Professor von der Dunk is part of, that studied this issue and released a report. There is a group called the Diego Group, which met last December. I was there to listen, and which is thinking about what to do. And there are informal consultation by the United States government with friend governments. Why? Because there is a point, an important point, that USA, in my mind, very clearly said, we can think about protection of the rights of private companies in outer space exploitation, but these companies should be aware that outside the jurisdiction of the United States, they will not have the same protection. So it is important to coordinate in a way with other governments, at least thinking about this, and they have taken an initiative in this sense. So I, of course, expect that Professor von der Dunk will address several other points, and I give the floor to Professor von der Dunk, at the same time giving him gifts from Professor Biagini, who is about to leave. And if I can open this, yes, there is the pin of the Sapienza University, the little angioletto, as we call it.
Del Borromini,
this is from Borromini. Okay, thank you. And some other papers from the Sapienza University, this is for you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now you have the floor, Frank.
Grazie mille, Professor Marchisio e Professor Biagini. Sono un olandese lavorando in Estados Unidos e parlo un pochito italiano. So I apologize, I will from now on speak in English. I thank also Professor Marchisio for his extended introduction, which allows me to go into some respects in more depth and more breadth, although in other respects I will probably also come back to what he said as such. I'm working in the United States, and we have this program that Professor Marchisio mentioned. If you're interested in it, I have a couple of flyers here, some information about the program, and you're always welcome to contact me if you're interested further in that. Since this group, as I understood it, is composed of various students focusing on humanitarian law, general public international law, administrative law, I thought I'd start with a broad discussion of the governance issue in out on the seas and in outer space, and then hopefully leave some time for your more particular questions and interests and discussion points. So that's what the table of contents is basically all about. I think it's, as lawyers, firstly, always important to think about what are we talking about. So I'm going to spend a few words on what is this governance concept, what do we mean by it, or at least what do I mean by it. If you mean something else, that's fine, but at least you understand that what I'm talking about. Obviously, then we'll focus on the governance of the seas, in particular the high seas, but in order to make you understand the bigger picture, you also should realize something about the general way the governance of the seas is dealt with, because the high seas are only part of it, and if you're out there, you probably don't even notice whenever you cross from the high seas into the territorial waters or vice versa. Then we move to outer space and do a kind of similar exercise on the international level to start with, on what governance of outer space means and how it has currently been addressed. A step further to that is national space law, because as Professor Marchisio already pointed out, one of the major paradigm changes in space activities is the increasing involvement of private commercial companies. They are not mentioned in the treaties, yet their activities have to be regulated, and the major legal instrument to do that is national space law. And we are going to address a few interesting aspects of how that works. And then finally, I'm going to address a couple of interesting specific areas where the two really meet, space law and the law of the high seas, the law of the seas, full stop, meet, have some things in common or interact with each other, because there are some activities going on which use both the high seas and outer space, or use outer space for the purpose of using the high seas. So that's what I'll end up with, so that gives you a general idea of what I'm going to talk about. By the way, whenever I'm talking, you have any question you want to, when I'm not clear, please feel free to raise your hand and raise a question, because it's always better that I'm aware of where I am not making myself perfectly understood. So before we go into the more substantive issues, we want to discuss briefly what is governance. Governance is the exercise of authority or control, but it's more than that. It's the method of exercising control and authority, basically in the international realm, in the world, in today's interconnected, globalized world. We need a system to govern or manage those international aspects, including, in particular, of course, what is commonly known as the global commons. So it's specifically about the activities of other actors, notably the private industry and other partners, but private industry is most important amongst those. And what is important to realize is that governance is more than government. It is not just referring to the government or the governments of individual states and how they exercise this control. It's one step higher. It includes intergovernmental organizations. It includes structural treaties, like the Outer Space Treaty already mentioned, which set out a structure on how individual governments and intergovernmental organizations can actually exercise authority and control over particular activities, again, most relevant for today, probably the private activities. And what the first thing which strikes a theoretical analyst of the concept of government is that this idea of distributing the exercise of authority, distributing the competence to control, is very much linked to territory, to areas, specifically geographically delineated areas, where a public entity, basically a state, does exercise control. And if you want to understand both the governance systems for the seas and for outer space, you have to realize this baseline assumption that states look for a territory. And of course, states are not the only entities involved in governance, but they're still the principal entities. And they like geographical clarity. They want to know, where does my authority stop? Where can my police still attack, apprehend offenders? Where can my army still exercise? Where can I give someone a license to exploit the mineral resources, etc., etc. If you look at general international law, it's probably fair to say that border conflicts are the most long duration and the most omnipresent and difficult ones in the international community. Think about the Israeli problem, the borders of Israel, whether occupied territories are part of Israel, whether Israel, in other words, can exercise governance over those territories or not. Currently, we're all faced with the problems with between Russia and Ukraine and the Crimea, which was taken by Russia as being part of Russia, which simply means that the Russian government is now also presumably legally in control. Now, of course, there are some illegal aspects to that, but the fact of the matter is that it's their laws which apply now in the Crimea. Morocco and Spanish Sahara is just another point. The other way around, if there is a territory where there is no government in control, that also is a very strong and obnoxious type of dispute in the international community. Think about the failed states like Somalia or Lebanon, Libya, Iraq nowadays, and maybe Palestine. The tendency of states to move into a legal void, if there is an area on earth, a failed state where there is on paper a government, but the paper doesn't really have any control over that area, there is a tendency of other states to move in, to take over that role. In Lebanon, Syria tries to establish a governmental position. Well, you know, I'm sure, the general politics of this. So again, territories are crucial to a state for the purpose of its own governance. States think in geographical terms. And also in a much more peaceful context, if you see about the internal subdivisions, federal states in a federal state, in a federation, or provinces or municipality, you can point them out on a map. You can draw exact border lines as to where a particular municipality starts and where it ends. So there is this inherent notion to seek for clarity on borders, to seek for a clearly delineated part of the earth where you are able to exercise control. Why? Because it clearly delineates the responsibilities and it delineates the rights. And think about the very important, the fundamental right of non-intervention. National sovereignty of states under the UN Charter means that no state has the right to intervene. That is thinking in a geographical sense. What does that mean, non-intervention? It means first and foremost that you don't move into the other state's territory without consent. Whether it's with an army or a police force or an aircraft, that's basically all the same. So the preoccupation of governance and governments with territory goes actually back a long way. A little bit of legal history here. Shortly after the Renaissance, this Western European notion of a modern state came up. And for example, one of my fellow countrymen, Hugo Grotius, he should be familiar to all of you who studied international law, was one of the first to propound something called the freedom of the high seas. And as a result, you now basically, from that moment on, you had basically three legal options of status when it came to either a part of the landmass, a part of a continent, a country, or a part of the seas. First of all, it could be state territory, which simply meant that that was under the sovereignty of a single state. That state had absolute control over the territory. Outside of state territory, there was the so-called no man's land, which was taken by the Latin phrase terra nullius, which of course means that it does belong to no one. However, no man's land, terra nullius, could become part of a state's territory by such legal concepts as occupation. We all know that European states in the 14th and 15th and 16th century went all over the globe, planted their flags, and thereby it's could consider that part of territory to be part of their own country. So the whole colonial period was based on this assumption that a state could move into what was considered no man's land, and by putting a flag there, by building a fortress there, by exercising control, could actually make that into state territory. So it moved from the one category to the other. There was from the beginning, and this is where Hugo Grotius comes in, there was a third category, which was also a kind of no man's land, but contrary to the terra nullius, this could never be occupied by anyone. This remained every man's land, or every man's sea, as it came to the high seas, of course. And this is where the term global commons was first coined. We have in common law countries, United Kingdom and the United States, we have this concept of a commons, which is a part, a park, or a nature reserve, which belongs not to any specific person, but to the state as a whole on behalf of the community. This sort of idea was then transported into international law. And of course, it's not a strictly speaking legal term, but it's a short label for terra communis. Now, for a long time in legal history, these three options remained the only options when it came to the legal status. And only recently, and that's also where the law of the high seas and the law of outer space became very important, two more options were added. One is this common heritage of mankind principle, which Professor Marchisio already referred to, where it is not just a matter of the territory is for everybody and is not subject to national appropriation, but also the use thereof and the exploitation thereof somehow is supposed to be common. The classical terra communis, number three, was still open for everyone to enjoy, and if you wanted to fish out on the high seas, you could do so freely in principle without any limitation. That concept was taken out when it comes to the common heritage of mankind, where the core idea is that also the use thereof, the benefits thereof, should be somehow common. There was this International Seabed Authority established for the law of the sea to make that specific, to create a very concrete regime for making sure that the exploitation of the ocean floor was going to be for the benefit of all and not just for the benefit of the one exploiting it. I'm going to come back to that in a little bit greater detail. And then the last term, and this comes actually, I've only seen it so far in legal documents at least, in the law of outer space, is the province of all mankind, which, because it was a new term, has sometimes been subject to efforts by states, in particular in the developing countries, to equate this with common heritage of mankind, and they said, well, it's basically the same, but other theoreticians have said, no, it's much more like a global commons idea, but then it has some additional profound new obligations when you want to be active in the global commons. So with this sort of theoretical schedule, I'm now going to move to the governance of the sea. And the one thing that immediately strikes the mind is that if you talk about the governance of the sea, indeed, this geographical approach comes back. It was basically from the start a zone-by-zone system. In the very early days, it was a very simple zone system. You basically had two zones. You had the territorial waters, and outside of that, there was the high seas. The territorial waters were defined by this cannon shot rule. Cannons were supposed to be able to shoot more or less 3 nautical miles, which is something like 5 or 6 kilometers offshore. And that was supposed, because that meant that a state could actually physically, militarily control that part of the waters just in front of the coast. The legal consequence was that that was actually part of the territorial sovereignty of the state. So 3 nautical miles was sort of the customary baseline for the customary borderline for the territorial waters. And at the time, it was rather absolute. If you were within the territorial waters, you fell completely within the state's, well, with one exception to which I'll come in a moment, but basically you fell completely within the sovereignty of the coastal state. That coastal state was entitled to keep foreign ships out of the territorial waters, or if it allowed them in the territorial waters, it was allowed to impose any conditions that it wanted. That was basically part of national sovereign territory. And as soon as you went beyond the 3 nautical miles, following Hugo Grotius, that was where nobody could claim any legal control as a state. This was every man's land, this was the high seas, this was the so-called global commons. And there was basically no intermediate zone. There was nothing in between. Now that started to change, in particular after the Second World War. And in 1958, in Geneva, a first approach was made to codify the existing rules in order to establish clarity, to make sure that all countries were aware that this was the baseline for creating a territorial water, that you could not, for example, by building a much better cannon which could shoot 10 miles, then suddenly claim 10 miles just because you had a better cannon. So what they did, as one of the main establishments, was that maximum territory of the territorial waters could be 12 nautical miles. It could be less. Some countries didn't want to claim 12 miles, stuck to the old 3 miles, or did something in between, but 12 miles was the maximum. But there were already much more exceptions to this dichotomy between totally territorial sovereignty over the territorial waters and the total freedom of the high seas. The first one, and that, as a matter of fact, was already established in older days, is the so-called idea of innocent passage. The idea that if you wanted to move from the high seas to another part of the high seas, or from the high seas to a harbor, it could be very efficient not to take the wide route just to avoid the territorial waters, but you were entitled to simply cut through, as long as, of course, your passage was innocent. This clearly was not innocent passage, right? So as long as you behaved well, as long as you did nothing to harm the interests in any legal sense of the coastal states, you were entitled to innocent passage. In addition, they created a first kind of intermediate zone, the so-called contiguous zone. Now, this is an interesting feature because also here it could not extend more than 12 miles offshore. So the idea was, if you claim 12 miles of territorial waters, you don't have any contiguous zone left. But if you claim 3 miles of territorial waters, then you are entitled to claim another 9 miles of a contiguous zone. And here you didn't claim as a state territorial sovereignty or anything like that. You just claimed that you were entitled to enforce the laws. So if the Coast Guard found within your territorial waters somebody not really behaving innocent, right, discharging oil, doing a military maneuver, then the ships of the Coast Guard were entitled not only to arrest that ship in the territorial waters, but they were allowed to go to chase it onto the contiguous zone and even further to make sure that the laws were protected there. So this was a kind of a functional jurisdiction limited to specific purposes and allowed by treaty, because in the 1958 Geneva Convention spelled out how that worked in detail. So an international convention here gave coastal states in a contiguous zone specific rights in abbreviation of the high seas, the freedom of the high seas. And then for some straits, so this is an example of a US Coast Guard, and then in some straits there was a specific regime. In the old days, when most of the territorial waters were only 3 miles, it was, for example, possible to navigate between Sicily and the toe of the Italian mainland. Because there was still a small part of high seas, and the Italian government under the old rules was not entitled to prohibit anyone from going there. Now, when suddenly the Italian government was able to claim 12 miles from both coasts, it started to overlap, which meant that it could now prohibit any foreign ships from going through that. But then historical tradition came up, and it was accepted that for straits of this nature, and there were of course more around the world, a special straits regime was created, which still allowed foreign ships to go between Sicily and Italian mainland in order not to make the large detour around Sicily when they wanted to go someplace else. This was still not enough. There was a need to create more coherence, and now I should point out some problems or some issues with the acronyms. These four Geneva Conventions were all negotiated at one major conference, the UN Conference on the Law of the Sea. This was called UNCLOS I. So here UNCLOS stands for the Conference on the Law of the Sea. And the four treaties which came from that, they had apparently four different treaties to deal with those issues. The first one with the territorial waters and the contiguous zone, then one with the high seas, and there were two specific ones dealing with the continental shelf and the fisheries. I can come back to that soon, but you already see that things started to become more and more complex. This historical twofold dichotomy was already gone. 2 years later, they already created or organized another conference of the UN to try to update, because there was so much developments going on. So this was UNCLOS II. Since this update was very unsuccessful, there were no amendments, no additional treaties created. You don't often see reference to UNCLOS II in the history books, but you need to know this in order to understand where UNCLOS III comes from. So in the 1970s, they started another conference, and this time it didn't just take a few months, it took 8 years, where the overriding goal was to create one unitary convention to cover all of these issues of the law of the sea. So the convention, the conference was called UNCLOS III, but then it resulted in a convention which is often now also referred to as UNCLOS III. So the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea of 1982, that is often abbreviated as UNCLOS III, and I want you to understand that. And that's the convention which still rules the governance structure to international waters as of today. And you can, from the following picture, immediately see that it was already refined, right? We see now, if you look at it more or less from an abstract perspective, we now see 5 zones outside of the internal waters. We see the territorial sea, which is this very small part on the left-hand side of the picture, which could, as you can already see, run still 12 miles offshore. But then you are allowed also to add another contiguous zone of another 12 miles. We see something like an exclusive economic zone, an EEZ, arising. And don't worry, I'm going to go through all of them in greater detail in the next couple of slides. And sometimes it was just about fisheries. There was this continental shelf, which only applied to the soil, the subsoil of the seas, but in a sense it was also geographically defined. And then only outside of all of those, you had the full old high seas where everybody could do what they wanted. Well, to a certain extent, we'll come to that. So let's briefly go through what these zones all meant in terms of governance and how international law tried to provide a governance structure to those. Well, of course, with the territorial waters, it was easy. They were close to the shore, and because there was territorial sovereignty, close to the shore, in other words, no more than 12 miles, because at the time, there were some states who tried to exercise control 200 nautical miles offshore. And they wanted to sort of limit that, because before you know it, the whole ocean would be carved up in territorial waters. So now they definitely said 12 miles, that is the ultimate limit of territorial sovereignty. And territorial sovereignty in terms of government simply means that you leave the governance to one state, namely the coastal state. For each territorial waters, of course, it could be a different one, but it was one state who determined on all feasible issues, whether it was environmental control, whether it was the control of immigration, whether it was the control of military exercise, or the harvesting of anything in the soil, that was all part of territorial sovereignty, of course only occasionally limited by general international law. The most prominent feature was still the continuing right of innocent passage in those areas. Territorial seas, the rights extend also to the airspace above that. So if you talk about aircraft, that part of the airspace is also still national airspace. Innocent passage, I already mentioned, that remains. And it is basically the only fundamental exception to full sovereignty of the coastal state over that area. There was another exception created of transit passage because of the 12 miles zone. This idea of special straits was now a little bit more harmonized, and there is an international strait regime, and when it comes to transit passage, you don't have this limitation to innocence. which basically means that warships are still able to pass through. That doesn't mean that they're allowed to shoot, because then other rules of the right to use force, of course, come into play, which limit that. But a warship, a Russian warship, could now pass through the Dardanelles between two parts of Turkey into the Mediterranean Sea without the Turkish government saying, well, this is a warship, this is not innocent passage, we prohibit that. And again, we are talking about from the high seas to the high seas, and it only applied to where, from the old days, there used to be transit already. If there was a new strait, then that didn't apply. The contiguous zone, as I said, limited to 24 miles offshores, and this was again this kind of functional quasi-territorial application of national jurisdiction, but only on this enforcement, on the protection of the shore. So it could mean also that in the contiguous zone, the coastal guard was entitled to board a foreign ship to check whether it wasn't doing anything wrong, but it was very much forced on monitoring and enforcement, and it didn't apply to full territorial sovereignty. We move further away. The exclusive economic zone was limited to 200 to 200 nautical miles. That figure is not an accident. I mentioned it before. In particular, in Latin America, there were some countries who wanted to keep control over, in particular, the fishing resources up to 200 miles offshore. And that's why, originally, they claimed territorial waters of that size. Because in the old days, that was the only way a national state could control the fisheries. Now they said, well, we have another tool for you, a more tailor-made, a more fine-tuned tool, and that's the exclusive economic zone. So here we are talking again about functional national jurisdiction, but only on natural resources, both the living, the fish, and the seafloor mineral resources. Now, in some cases, the countries concerned didn't consider it necessary to do something for all the subsoil, and there was also a continental shelf regime which interfered with that, so they simply called this a fishery zone. But then also the entitlement goes only as far as 200 miles offshore. And otherwise, the freedoms of the high seas, the rules of the high seas, continue to apply. And I'm going to come to what those freedoms are in a second. So again, you see a mixed form of governance here, right? When it comes to the economic exploitation of the fish or the oil in the soil, it is the natural, it's the coastal state, which in principle is entitled to determine who can do that, the governance system. But on the other aspects, for example, the right to pass a ship through that area, it is still an international regime which applies. The freedom of the high seas. I already said that the continental shelf overlapped, so the regime which was included is a sort of interesting combination of geological circumstances where there is still a relatively shallow sea floor, and at a certain point offshore it drops very deep and that's where it stops. But they also have some figures on both sides. You can, whatever the geological circumstances, you can claim at least 200 miles of continental shelf, in which case it somehow sort of coincides with your economic zone. But if the geological circumstances allow, you can extend it further out, but never further to 350 miles. Even if the real drop into the high seas is 400 nautical miles out. And this was also, it's basically the same as the exclusive economic zone, but this only focused on mineral resource exploitation. I'm not going to go into the details, but you can imagine that there may be some legal problems between the fact that both the EEZ and the continental shelf regime, to a certain extent, overlap. But I'm not going to go into those. And also here, of course, above the, so we are talking about oil platforms, right? Things like that. But above the continental shelf as such, again, all the rules of the high sea, the other rules of the high sea continue to apply. And the high seas was all that was left outside. So as further than 200 miles offshore or 315 nautical miles when some continental shelf cases, the high seas were never subject to the exercise of territorial sovereignty. So again, that's why we sometimes use this term global commons. And I'm going to explain a little bit more in detail how, nevertheless, the high seas were governed. There was a governance system. It doesn't mean that the freedoms were total, that everybody could really do what they wanted. And in view of the time, shall we do a break now or shall we do a break in 10 minutes? What do you think?
You can finish this part.
Okay, then, yeah, I'll finish on the sea, and so that's a few more slides, and then we do a break, and then we are ready to take off into outer space. So the freedom, the main point of the high seas government, sort of the baseline rule, is that you are free to do whatever you want, unless there is an international limitation to it, right? Because you're not part of another state's territory, so if an Italian ship is out on the high seas, neither the United States or the Russians or the French or the Dutch can tell that Italian ship what to do or what not to do, because US law doesn't apply, Russian law doesn't apply, etc., etc. So that's the baseline. And it was spelled out in a little bit greater detail. So the freedoms of navigation are usually six. The most important one is the navigation freedom, then the right to steer your ship to that area. To lay submarine cables and pipelines, well, that could already interfere with some of the continental shelf rights. But in particular, the next one, to construct artificial islands and other installations, that was, of course, no longer true for the continental shelf and the exclusive economic zone, because there it was subject to the coastal state to allow anyone to do that thing. So there, this particular freedom of the high sea only applies when you're really far out, 200 or 350 miles and more. The right to fish, again, except where an exclusive fishery zone or an EEZ was called for, and then the right of economic scientific research. And beyond that, the limitations to those freedoms could only be set on the international level, by international agreement, by international treaties. That was essentially the governance system for the high seas. So one example thereof is that the UNCLOS 3 itself provided already for a further limitation. You are only allowed to use the high seas for peaceful purposes. Perhaps in self-defense, the rules of self-defense in the charter could, in theory, apply to the high seas as well, but you have a problem already there, because self-defense applies to national territory, and the high seas cannot be any state's national territory. Other than that, you find, however, a number of additional regimes, specific treaty law and customary law, which do limit the freedom nowadays to do on the high seas what you want. And I'm just going to run you through a few of them. There is a special regime for the exploitation of mineral resources. Professor Marchisio made reference to that. When in the 1970s it was thought to become feasible to start harvesting those manganese nodules on the ocean floor, the UNCLOS Convention did provide for an international regime ruling that exportation. And as a matter of fact, UNCLOS 3 went quite far. There's a whole chapter with, I think, something like 30 or 40 articles spelling out how that works in detail. There was an international seabed authority, which is basically on behalf of the community of states applying these rules and making sure that indeed everyone can benefit, so that there is a possibility to get a license, but only if the international parameters are honored. It includes a benefit of, under the old UNCLOS at least, it included a system of benefit sharing. Also, countries who were not able to participate in those actual exploitation activities were supposed to get some benefit from it. And there was a mandatory transfer of technology. And this resulted in a lack of acceptability to the major Western states. United States, United Kingdom, Italy, Germany, Japan, they said, well, if you create a system like that, nobody's going to invest millions in trying to harvest these resources if then everyone can say, I want the same technology that you used, give me the blueprints, and you also should give me a share of your benefits. So those states at the time refused to ratify UNCLOS 3. And it led to renegotiations, We fast forward 12 years. Professor Marchisio made reference to the New York Agreement in 1994, which was effectively the agreement which diluted these concerns of the Western states. In a sense, it diluted the effect of applying this common heritage of mankind principle to the ocean floor. And now we do see that many licenses have been given by the International Seabed Authority, including notably to Western companies. Very interesting point to the side here. The United States, till today, refuses to ratify the New York Agreement, or following the New York Agreement, UNCLOS 3. They are still not a party because, you know, the United States is the ultimate private enterprise, the ultimate free-for-all type of country for commercial business. So they consider this still too limiting. But when a private U.S. company, Lockheed Martin, wanted to start an exportation on the ocean floor, they could perhaps legally have said the United States is not a party to this regime. We can ignore this. We just get a national U.S. license, and who does something to us? Who dares to interfere with our activities, right? But they didn't choose to do that. Instead, they developed a subsidiary entity in the United Kingdom, a daughter company for these purposes, and the United Kingdom has now accepted this. So they got a UK license in line with the International Seabed Authority's license. So you see that there is some moral power of this international system, even to companies of countries that do not formally accept. And this is also very interesting for the future governance discussion. A second special regime was necessary to preserve the fish. If we would just fish, if everybody would fish with modern day technologies, within 10 years there would be no more fish left in the ocean. So everybody realized we needed some international agreements to limit ourselves. So there are some, indeed, some treaties which limit the right to fish in the high seas. A 1993 Rome Agreement promotes compliance with international conservation and management measures by fishing vessels on the high seas. So all the states party to this agreement agree that they should control their national fishing boats and make sure that they don't fish more than the quota that somehow are allocated to them. A further agreement deals with the specific element of straddling fish stocks, which are huge stocks of fish, parts of which are in an exclusive fishery zone and parts of which are in the high seas. Now, if you only apply this regime to the high seas, it could mean that one single state could still fish its own part empty, and then no doubt other parts of the same stock, and the same flock, would move in. So if you really want this to be effective, you have to make sure that also states in their own exclusive fishery zone accept this. But it was mainly focused on the high seas. And as a matter of fact, UNCLOS 3 already referred to this, but only referred to this in a very summary fashion, and the 1993 and 1995 agreements were elaboration of that. Another big issue on today, in today's world, the environment. If you allow, if you apply the complete freedoms of the high seas, basically you could argue, well, it gives me the freedom to discharge all my old oil in the high seas, and I don't care about what it does to the environment. That is no longer acceptable. So already in 1973, a London convention, the so-called MARPOL convention, created rules trying to limit the pollution by ships. It was later modified in 1978, and it, for example, one thing that it did, not only prohibit pollution, but also impose a double hull on oil tankers and a compartmentalization, so that if something happened with a major oil tanker, the chances that it would leak immediately into the ocean would be much less because they had a much stronger hull. And because of the compartmentalization, not the whole ship would empty, but just a part of it. Now, of course, this is all for a ship owner, means additional cost. A single hull tanker is much more cheap than a double hull tanker. If you want to build compartments, it means you have different filling systems. It's all more expensive. So you need to force that to those tanker owners as part of your governance of the environmental aspects of the high seas, and that you do that through forcing the governments to do that to their ships, to their shipping companies. There's a special regime for search and rescue at sea. in 1974, a London Convention addressed that, and as a matter of fact, various systems of support were established, including satellites, so I'm going to come back to that later. And this is going to be my final slide before the break, just to sort of round off the picture, to give you an idea, the intergovernmental organizations can very much serve as an important tool in promoting these government systems. I already mentioned the UN indirectly, but we have also an International Maritime Organization, an IMO, which strictly speaking is not a government, but it can develop standards, which states then are at least politically supposed to comply with, or maybe integrate into national law. It can develop guidelines, and it can, of course, develop treaty text, and then tell the member states, guys, this is a beautiful treaty, you should all ratify that, and put political pressure, and thereby help governance in the right direction. Another tool which we should note is the nationality of ships. If you register a ship, it bears your flag, and it allows the home state to control whatever that ship is doing. For example, prohibit it from discharging oil into the sea, or prohibiting it from taking more fish than it is allowed to. Also, the nationality of companies, the fishing companies, of course, you can exercise national jurisdiction on the basis of the registration or the seat of the company. If a company is located in Napoli, then the Italian government can tell the company, you only get an operating license from us, you're only allowed to operate to get your fish in the Mediterranean Sea if we are sure that you will comply with a certain set of requirements. And then finally, of course, you can also apply the nationality-based jurisdiction over persons with your nationality. In space, everything goes much faster than on the seas, so this second part of the class will also go much faster. But I will give my slides to Professor Marchisio electronically so that you may have access to them and later read back what I said. And actually, before we move into outer space, I just have one special case which also is often discussed in governance context of the Global Commons. Antarctica, the South Pole area, where there are some states which say this is terra nullius and we claim part of it, Argentina and Chile, for example, but there are also countries who say, no, no, this is a res communis, and Antarctica is a very interesting example of how governance in a global commons can sort of address this issue. The Antarctic Treaty sort of froze the territorial question, so it didn't touch it, it didn't solve it either way, but it was possible to basically say we agree to disagree and work on that basis. And then a number of further treaties protecting the environment and the ecosystem at large resulted in a very strong limitation to exploitation activities to protect the environment. So as a matter of fact, you could now say that the fact that some states still claim that they have a national right to license doesn't mean much because they cannot exercise that right because they are held to this strong obligation not to license anyone. And just for the completion's sake, but you will find that on the slides, these are the conventions that have gradually built up that system, and in particular the last one, the 1991 Madrid Protocol on Environmental Protection, is very strong on this issue. So with that, with the coldest place on Earth, we take off and we move from two dimensions to three. And I wanted to give you, because I assume that not many of you are familiar with that familiar with space, a very brief overview. It started, of course, with the first human artifact, Sputnik 1, launched in 1957. 4 years later, the first human entered outer space. Then, of course, we saw Neil Armstrong landing on the moon, which, by the way, meant for the first time someone setting foot on another body, another celestial body in the universe. Does that require governance issues? Not as of yet, perhaps. In 1981, the Space Shuttle was the first vehicle which allowed repeated access to space. In 1998, we saw the International Space Station become inhabited, where for the first time we now have a set of humans, usually of different nationalities, living in a very confined area in outer space for months or even years at a time. That's at some point requires some governance. So gradually this issue of governance becomes important. However, so far this was all about certainly when it comes to humans, it was all about public space flight, but now we have another phenomenon, and that is the You may have, if you have followed this, you may have noticed that some things have changed. The date has not been kept. It's now 4 years after 2011, and it still hasn't flown, but it will take one or two more years, and the price has gone up. But basically, this is about to happen, and this now starts, and other events, starts to raise the issue of governance in space. Now, the most fundamental treaty in space is, of course, the Outer Space Treaty, which basically confirms the status of space as this province of all mankind, a global commons plus. The province of all mankind means that there is a freedom of exploration for states, freedom of use, which is basically considered by most to include exploitation, and there's no national appropriation. So the fact that you can buy parts of the moon on the internet is a legal hoax, is fraud, doesn't really make sense. And again, like on the ocean, so this, the fact that Neil Armstrong planted the US flag on the moon, contrary to Earth, did not mean that the moon could become part of the US. Like on the high seas, where outer space is then most compared with, the limitations to freedoms can only basically be imposed by international law, either customary or treaty law. The Outer Space Treaty itself provides just for a few limits. It says you are not allowed to prohibit, you're not allowed to orbit or station weapons of mass destruction. But most of those limitations then come from other treaties. And vice versa, Professor Marchisio has already made reference to that, it makes states responsible for also their own private operators. And that's, of course, where governance comes in. The states are made responsible to make sure that private operators comply with the international rules of the game in outer space. That is the governance structure. And not only they are responsible, they're also held liable. They are going to pay for any damage caused by a private venture into outer space. And then registration allows for jurisdiction. Just to give you a few examples of further limitations to the international freedom, the UN Charter and general international law, which apply as a lex generalis, of course, apply the rules on the prohibition of use of force in outer space. In principle, it remains to be seen to what extent an attack on a satellite is to be seen as an attack on national territory. There are some issues there, but of course, in principle, you're not allowed to start a war of aggression in outer space, just as you are not allowed to do that on Earth. There are a number of treaties drafted in the UN context specifically to elaborate the Outer Space Treaty. Usually these are the four ones mentioned. I'm going to come back to the Moon Agreement a little later on because that is a very special one. There are the test ban treaties which prohibit nuclear weapons explosions also in outer space. And there are a number of specialized treaty regimes. One of them refers specifically to the International Space Station and how governance is applied to that multinational body in outer space. And there are UN resolutions giving rise to customary law. Now I'm going to discuss a little bit in greater detail two main problems in governance context of space, which have recently raised a lot of concern. And one is this issue of space debris or space junk. This is how some pictures show you the amount of space junk that is floating around the Earth. And unfortunately, there is no prohibition to do something like that in the UN treaties. There is no prohibition to blow something up in outer space, not even if it's your own satellite, as was the case with the Chinese in 2007 and the United States in 2008. The only requirement that the Outer Space Treaty provides here is to inform upfront that you are going to do something which might harm the other party. And this is what the Chinese did not do, but what the Americans did do, which makes the Americans act in quite in conformity with the rules of, at the time, but the Chinese only in this context made them violate international law. Well, of course, if space debris causes damage, luckily the state that launched it is at least liable, but that still requires that you're able to find out who is liable. And if it's just a piece of dead metal which has been flying in outer space for 10 years, that may be a major issue. There is no concept, no legal concept of abandonment in outer space, as we know that in the law of the sea, where if you find a shipwreck that is in harm's way, everybody's able to take it out to make sure that shipping is more safe. Doesn't apply to outer space. Consequently, there are also no salvage rights in outer space, whereby the insurance companies may provide an incentive for people to actually take out dangerous stuff because they pay for it. Doesn't apply to outer space. Major problem. So the efforts that are now undertaken are of a very early nature. It is a coordination committee of the space agencies, the main space agency of the world, who drafted only 13 years ago a set of guidelines, which has meanwhile been promoted to the level of a UN resolution. And the elements thereof are now used in national licensing processes. So you see this filtering down of international governance to the national level. If you want a license to launch a satellite, for example, in the United Kingdom or in the United States, you need to comply with those guidelines, otherwise you don't get your license. So this is already a little bit of a start, but of course it's not enough. So what do they do further? Well, they first of all focus on two types of orbits which are really important today, which run the risk of being very much spoiled, which are the big one out there, the geostationary orbit, and the ones very close to Earth, the low Earth orbits, because that's where the most satellites are flying right now. So you see the altitudes here in the picture. And what you are not so any longer supposed to do is just leave something to break up. You should take active measures to prevent an all-orbit breakup. You should remove space objects at the end of their life, shoot them out into deep space, or bring them back to Earth so that they are burning up in the atmosphere, and that gets them out of harm's way. And you should limit the purposeful release of objects. Just throw out empty fuel or a hammer or whatever you're doing in order to keep space as clean as possible. But we are not there yet. And then the other interesting development is, of course, the regulation of harvesting of celestial bodies of mineral resources. After the moon landings were so successful, some 40 plus years ago, the mining of lunar resources seems around the corner, and it was felt necessary to create a regime which elaborated the Outer Space Treaty, because the Outer Space Treaty only said you can't appropriate the moon, but it didn't provide any further detail. So an effort was made in 1979 by way of this moon agreement, which applies, by the way, also to other celestial bodies. The companies that Professor Marchisio mentioned are aiming for the asteroids so far and not for the moon as such. But the idea is that the exploration and the use of the moon may be the province of all mankind, which still allows everyone to go there on its own and exploit, in particular if you think that the use is including commercial exploitation. But at the same time, the moon and the natural resources are mentioned as the common heritage of mankind. Now, different from the law of the sea, in the law of outer space, this regime was not elaborated. But everyone thought that it would be elaborated along the same lines. So all the major Western states said, wait a minute, this is not going the way we want it. They refused to ratify, and so far there are only 16 parties to the Moon Agreement, and none of them are major spacefaring nations. So we are confronted with a similar situation in the law of outer space, a refusal of Western countries to ratify a regime which was considered anti-private enterprise. But different from the law of the sea, we have not come to any solution in outer space yet. We have mainly two companies, Deep Space and Planetary Resources, who actually prepare missions to go there and harvest the resources. Now, on the one hand, if you read the treaties, the treaty in particular also, even the Moon Agreement, it does not prohibit the ownership of resources once you took them out of the soil. What it does prohibit is to reserve a priori, a part of the Moon, and says, here we are going to harvest, everyone else keeps out. And most companies who are interested in doing that, they want such a keep-out zone. So that's where the problems arise. And apart from that, there are some countries who do not agree with the system in the first place, and who say, we don't want to accept that that the United States in particular can just license under the Asteroids Act a company going there, harvesting it, and act as if it's the property of that particular US company, because the moon is not US territory. Who is the United States to determine how that works there? Basically, there are two possible solutions here. One is the solution of a unilateral domestic regime. Before the New York Agreement in 1994 changed the situation in the law of the sea, what happened was that the United States and Italy and the United Kingdom had their own national deep seabed mining acts under which you could get a license, so regardless of the international treaty. But under 1994, that changed. But this is the situation we are here now, because this Asteroids Act, this US Asteroids Act, is precisely doing that. And then just see, are others going to copy? Are they going to follow? Are they going to accept that? Or will there be an international counter-movement saying, no, we need an international solution? And that's, of course, what an international lawyer should prefer, not allow individual countries to go ahead and then you get some automatic movement to some sort of customary legal rule, perhaps, but a clear international regime. Another issue which I will, in view of time, not spend too much effort on, but it's important for governance reason, because airspace is sovereign and outer space is free, so you could compare airspace to the territorial waters and outer space to the high seas, that you need a boundary between them. And as I said, I won't go into the details, but here you can see that aircraft, even the Concorde when it flew, were still flying at altitudes of 20 or 25 kilometers, and nobody had a problem with that. That was clearly airspace. But when it comes to these suborbital flights, these tourist flights, Virgin Galactic is another one, they go to 100, 110, 120 kilometers, and they claim that that's outer space. So there is a need for a boundary between airspace and outer space to regulate, to determine which system of governance applies. Is it the outer space system of governance, where you have an international global commons and international treaties, or is it the airspace system of governance, which is basically dependent upon the sovereignty of national states? I won't go into this debate, but this is an important point. General lack of agreement on altitude, although I do see a convergence on 100 kilometer at altitude. So maybe 10 years from now, we can come to the conclusion that 100 kilometers is the established customary international legal boundary, but it doesn't exist yet. Also in outer space, we have some special governance tool. Again, you have the international organizations. The UN has a very important body to discuss legal developments, and Professor Marchisio was chairman of the legal subcommittee of the Committee on the Peaceful Use of Outer Space of the United Nations handling these issues a few years ago. So that's where these issues are discussed, which can help guide states on how they should exercise their governance. There is an International Telecommunication Union which regulates the access to frequencies for the use of communication with the satellites. And there are intergovernmental satellite operators. Some of them have now been privatized, Intelsat, Inmarsat, and Eutelsat. Some of them are still intergovernmental, Intersputnik, Arabsat, and EUMETSAT. We have the European Space Agency, and we also now have the WTO, the World Trade Organization, and the European Union, who step into trying to govern the access to satellite communication markets in particular. But the most important tool in this outer space area of global commons for governance purposes is still national law, because it's the national states which then can control and make sure that these activities of these private operators in particular, whether they go to the moon to harvest or whether they send persons out there or whether they risk a satellite to create a lot of debris out there, is national space legislation. You use the fact that most space activities, and that's a major difference with the law of the sea, are still remote controlled. You have someone on Earth who guides the satellite up there. That someone on Earth is sitting in one territory or another. There's an Italian ground control station, or a Dutch one, or a US one. So the Italian law, Italy, can control, legally control, whatever that operator is doing, even if the main effect is in outer space. So it's an indirect governance tool for outer space. Of course, when it comes to manned space flight, the fact that an astronaut is an Italian, the fact that he then travels into space doesn't take away his nationality. He continues to be an Italian in principle. He is subject to Italian jurisdiction. And then the registration under the Registration Convention allows, similar to ships on the ocean, the country sending the space object out to offer some, to exercise jurisdiction. You use the international space law to implement the international obligations under the treaty vis-à-vis the private operators to make sure that they operate in conformity with the international rules. And then, of course, you can also implement national legal concerns or national policies. If you want to stimulate private enterprise, as is very much the case in the United States, you create a national space law which is very pro-enterprise. So I'm going to make a brief tour de horizon to show you roughly how that works. And I'm, as I said, I'm going to run through it very quickly, but since you will get the slides, it's more important now to get the general idea than the details of all these national laws. In the US, multiple acts have been enunciated. The 1934 Communications Act was because in 1934, of course, there were no satellites, but in 1970, it was declared to be applicable also to satellite communication. So if you need a license, if you want to operate a satellite communication satellite in the US, you need a license from the US Federal Communications Commission. And in that context, the US now also requires the licensee a payload approval, including reference to the space debris guidelines. So before you get your license from the FCC, you have to show that you are a good citizen, you're going to be a good citizen in outer space and comply with the international rules. For land remote sensing, for Earth observation, you have a different act and a different licensing authority in the US, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. I will skip this act because it doesn't do that much in clear terms. It has something on the GPS and on the ISS. But I will continue to the most important one, which is the Commercial Space Launch Act. 1984, the private launch of any space object from within the United States or outside the United States, if it's a US company, requires a license. And that also applies to an operation of a private launch site. Now, in the license, also there is a payload approval. So again, the US authorities can make sure that the satellite which is going to be launched is relatively safe and is operating in conformity with other international obligations. In 1988, they created, furthermore, specific clauses on sharing the international third-party liability. And remember, there's state liability in outer space. So if a private launch operator crashes into Mexico, it's the US government which has to pay Mexico the damage, not the private operator. But the license allows the US government to go back to the private operator and get a license there. And then in 2004, this regime was also applied to manned spaceflight. So two slides on the US, because they are by far the most extended, but the Tour de Horizon takes us to Norway, where in 1969, an act on launching space objects provided for the need to have a permission. Sweden followed 13 years later. Any space activities, only launching of sounding rockets, scientific rockets, were excluded. So you see that different nations apply different concepts as to precisely how to implement their international rules. The UK was the next one. This is chronological, by the way. Outer Space Act, which requires a license for all space activities, and even if you want to buy a launch, which is as such not a space activity, because you just pay someone else to do the space activity for you. Russia came in there after communism went out of the window in 1993. Again, a license is required. And here it's very extended. Even the use of space technology may give rise to that requirement. South Africa in 1993, same story, although they have a different approach. Ukraine is very much like the Russians in 1996. And again, I apologize for the speed of sound with which I run through these slides. Australia, 1998, Act on Space Activities, with a very complicated licensing regime. As a matter of fact, four different types of licenses to very much tailor the need for whatever is to be licensed. Brazil, very interesting because it's the first major developing country doing so, basically because they have a launch site close to the equator, very interesting for launches. Belgium, and we go back to Europe here, a law on space activities. South Korea first, an important spacefaring country. And then the Netherlands, going back to Europe again. France, 2008, authorization required, etc., etc. And now we're very close to today. Austria is the last European nation so far, and you will know that Italy is missing on the list. And Kazakhstan is the last state, full stop. Where the license is still very much in a general sense. So whom are we missing? Major states. Oh, we are missing Japan, People's Republic of China, North Korea. Well, maybe we shouldn't take that too seriously because nobody wants to launch from North Korea except the North Koreans themselves, right? There's India. There's Indonesia, Canada, Germany, and as I said, Italy. So we still need a lot of governance tools for outer space. Now, what I would actually propose, Professor Marchisio, in view of the time, is to leave it at this and allow some time for questions. As I said, the slides, you can have access to them, and you can always email me if something goes wrong there, so you can look at the rest of the interaction examples at your leisure, but I wanted to give you the opportunity to at least ask a few questions in this regard before we have to close. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for this very, very complete picture of the framework, legal framework of both kind of space regimes, and I strongly recommend you now to ask any questions or make any comment you want to do. Just not much questions because we are quite exhausting our time, but please, I see Gianfranco, then is there any other wishing to ask something? Yes, Gianfranco, please.
Okay. Thank you, Professor, for your presentation. I would like to ask you, in the governance system of other space activities, which can be the role for civil society, but not civil society intended like private companies, the other civil societies, because they have an important role on human rights and also environmental matters, but in other space, miss the civil society perspective.
That's a very good question, and actually by asking it you almost give the answer already. It is missing. Why is it missing? I think that goes back to the history of space activities being something which requires an awful amount of money and still is a highly risky activity. So if we look at it from a global perspective, there's just a handful of nations which have the which are able to operate the full breadth of space activities. There may be a dozen or so states which have independent launch capability, which means that when it comes to individual pressure groups and other non-governmental parts of the civil society, they are way back behind. We only very gradually see some elements of the thinking of civil society filter in. There's, for example, in recent years, there's been an effort to insert ethics into the space law debates, and Professor Marchisio, you know probably more than I about this thing, but UNESCO, for example, made a big pitch. The idea being that space should not only be about military, because if it is about military, or nowadays also about money, but that there are also more broader interests of humanity, if you will, so that's where maybe civil society comes in, which should be respected somehow. But from the way I formulated it, you can already imagine that it hasn't gotten much further than that. And the specific types of interest that civil society entities, organizations, and NGOs usually promote, human rights, welfare of animals, solidarity with third world nations, that is hardly something which is on the main front of space, I would say. Only the environment is now a real issue, but the environment in outer space is still something totally different from what we talk about Earth. And we talk about pieces of metal which are floating around, which may harm satellites. We are not talking about oil pollution on the sea, which may kill fish, which may, you know, cause damage to or kill seabirds. Or cause environmental or health problems to the population. So it is something which is missing, and that has to do with the specific nature of manned spaceflight. And even human rights, and then I will stop. The concerns that human rights usually address are not really appropriate in outer space. You know, there may be a little bit of discrimination sometimes, but there is no torture, there is no genocide, there is no you know what I'm saying? If these are the types of elements that you want to address, sure, there may be an issue with rights to courts or something like that, or rights of due fair process. But we haven't even seen a single crime being committed yet in outer space. We have some very limited criminal law rules on how to address something like that on the International Space Station, but it hasn't occurred. So the concern with, you know, everyone should have a lawyer to give just another idea of humanitarian rights, we are too early in the game, I would say. I hope that sort of answers you.
That I see also two points concerning human rights, which are, in my mind, important, connected to outer space law, and they are right to information because of the utilization of satellite for telecommunications, and the cases where states have stopped the functioning of such satellites for avoiding information to go through their territory. The big case between Eutelsat and Iran, the jamming of the Eutelsat satellites. And the second one is the right to privacy, because with remote sensing technologies, it is possible to be very, very intrusive in the private life of persons. Yeah. And these are only two examples in my mind. Okay.
I absolutely agree, but I think it also, at the same time, again, illustrates a little bit my point. If you take the last one, I was 15 years ago, I was phoned by a German businessman who had visited Mount Athos in Greece, which is of course this religious community, is also a self-governing territory, where only male persons are allowed for religious reasons. And there are of course tourists going into the and then come back with it. They are impressed by what they see. The total atmosphere is something. Apparently, I've never been there. Something very special. This businessman wanted to make a business out of selling the people coming out of Mount Athos a satellite picture of these of the peninsula, where you could see the various monasteries and the mountain sites in between. And the Greek government prohibited that. Him from doing so, which was a kind of a privacy-related issue, because the Greek government wanted to protect the religious privacy of the island. They didn't want any intrusion. And he told me, but the Outer Space Treaty allows me to take those pictures. And that is the divide. Outer space law still allows you to interfere with privacy, but it's national laws, which only for the national territory, can prohibit that. So the Greek government was, of course, entitled to prohibit the German businessman from selling this stuff in Greece. He could go back to Germany and start selling the pictures from Germany, because the Greeks might not have an opportunity to prevent that. So this is one area where you see that the interest in privacy is now gearing up, and so is the interest in information as a human right. But it's still conflicts with the basic freedom of outer space. So outer space law hasn't taken that into consideration yet. We need a much stronger civil society push in the publicity to make that happen. Thank you. Good point. That's an excellent question, and I should really have an hour to answer that, but there's so many behind it. But I'm just going to give you a few points. The European Union, and the Commission in particular, has of course tried already for a decade or more, basically, to get control over European space policy. And to cut a long story short, they have not succeeded. They have a framework agreement with ESA, which, yes, allows the EU to apply its procurement rules, so no juste retour, but free competition to its space projects. But the framework agreement also allows ESA, and notably ESA member states, to continue to apply their industrial policy to their projects. So the only place where the EU can now effectively control that is when they pay ESA, hire ESA to do certain things, which is taking place in Galileo and also Copernicus, the second EU satellite system for Earth observation. That's where the EU is in the driver's seat. They pay, and if you pay, you determine what's going on. So they pay ESA to develop some of the technology in the initial stages, and there they can say, and then we force ESA to comply with competition rules as opposed to Feritor. But other than that, ESA doesn't have to comply, and the member states of ESA don't want it because they think ESA is a very good tool for that. And the Commission has also been rebuffed following the Lisbon Treaty. This clause in the Treaty on the Functioning of European Union, Article 189, which says that the European Union can create space programs, and they even can create regulations or directives on space, which, by the way, they had already been able to do in some specific context, satellite communications, but okay, now it's over the whole broad. But they cannot harmonize national space laws. And we have six EU member states, UK, Sweden, Belgium, Netherlands, Austria, and France, who have already a national space law licensing private operations. So if it comes to that sort of governance, the EU is still back to square one. They can only create a European-wide regime in an area where no member state has already entered into, which is, you know, there's not that much left in one sense. I mean, there are some, again, I don't want to go too much into detail because of the time, but my conclusion is that so far the EU hasn't played their cards very, very smartly. And one thing which I would have suggested to them and have suggested to them a couple of times is the first thing you need to do is become an intergovernmental organization which accepts the rights and duties of the Liability Convention and the Registration Convention. Those conventions allow intergovernmental organizations to almost be on a par with ratifying states as being parties to the legal regime. It means that you can actually put an EU flag on a Galileo satellite, which you can still do, but formally it is not an EU satellite. It's either going to be registered by the European Space Agency or by an individual country. For example, Germany, because the Galileo Center, it might be in Germany or, you know, whatever. But they refuse to do that because they are too proud to admit that they are that they should qualify as an intergovernmental organization. They say, we are the EU, we are special. We are not an intergovernmental organization, we are a supranational legal order of ourselves.
Do not exaggerate.
Well, okay.
I mean, as an Italian, I like the system of just return, I'm sorry. And then, yeah. In my mind, the fact that the European Union is based on the rule of competition is something that I have some doubt, because there is a very big amount of just return also in the European Union. Some states gain much more than the others,
true, yeah.
Than others.
Absolutely.
There are the financial perspectives yeah. That are decided upon to allow some yeah. State to have their return.
Yeah. Eh? Yeah.
They are preliminary to the decision. In ISA, yes, yeah. Is all much clearer. You can invest in ISA and you have some return.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
Is the
no,
problem.
I fully agree, and I mean this is.
I
one
don't
of
think that Italy could have a space policy without the system of just
no,
return.
No.
I can. I'm sure that we couldn't have.
Thank you once again.
I apologize. We, of course, thank you very much for this interesting presentation, and we hope to see you again very soon in Rome.
Thank you.